Happy Resurrection Sunday. Everyone looks so beautiful. The colors and the energy that I feel in this room is contagious. Welcome, welcome. And for those, if this is your first time here, every morning before service, we do a brief meditation. It's an opportunity for us to just silence ourselves and come together as one. So that's what we're going to do this morning on this glorious, glorious day. Welcome. So find that place where you feel comfortable and allow your hands to rest softly on your lap and gently close your eyes. And just notice your breath and allow your body to come to that place of stillness and breathe. Christ has risen. Christ has risen indeed. Proclaim and celebrate and respond to the resurrected Jesus with amazement and joy. Resurrection brings hope to the world, a gift to all of us, a gift of new life. Romans 8:11. And if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of his spirit who lives in you. The promise of Easter, renewal and restoration, the power to live like him. As we celebrate the beauty of the resurrection, let us focus our thoughts on this opportunity to extend this selfless love that was shared with us so that we can share it with others. Continue to pray as a community and thank God for sending his Son to save us from our sins. And always remember this ultimate sacrifice. So breathe in life and the splendor of this day. As you gently breathe in, slowly release the breath, and allow your eyes to softly open. Christ has risen. Christ has risen indeed. Enjoy the service, church family.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Happy Resurrection Sunday. This is the reason why we are here. Amen? Amen? Hold on now. Hold on, because, you know, y'all sitting up here looking all nice. Y'all need to be proud. Amen? He got up, y'all. He got up with all power in his hands. Amen? You know, 1 Corinthians 15:55. It says, where, oh, where death is your victory? Where, oh, death is your sting? The sting of death is sin, but thanks be to God, he gives through his Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's go into this. Edwin Hawkins, one of my very favorite writers and singers, may he rest in eternal peace, wrote a great song called He Got Up. Now, there's a few people in here. Is that Chris Broussard? That's my brother right there. Here it is, y'all. If this don't get you up, I don't know what will. Amen. Let's put our hands together. Come on. Let's say right here. Let's say right here. Let's go right in this. We're going to say,
death, where is your sting? Sting, where is your grave? Grave, where is your victory?
Say,
he got up. God raised him up. Yes, he got up. All power in his hands.
Let's say that again. He got up.
He got up.
Hey,
God raised him up.
Yes,
he got up with all power in his hands.
Let's bring it real low. Let's say,
death, where is your sting? Sting, where is your grave? Grave, where is your victory?
What did he do, y'all?
He got up.
Yes, he did. Yeah, yes.
He got up.
Yeah.
All power in his hands.
Let's say that one more time. Let's say,
death, where is your sting?
Sting, where's your grave?
Sting, where is your grave?
Grave, where's grave, your victory?
Where is your victory?
Yes, say,
he got up.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. Yeah,
God raised him up.
Yes, he did. Y'all, hold on, y'all. This is the resurrected Christ we're singing about, y'all.
Yeah.
This is the resurrected Savior we're singing about, y'all.
Yeah.
I mean, he got up with all power in his hands.
Yeah.
See, this is the beginning of the church. This is the beginning of the early church.
Yeah.
This is the beginning of the early church fathers out of Africa, out of Asia, out of Europe. This is the beginning of modern Christianity, where we are today. This is the beginning of where we are as a community. Yeah. Y'all, the black church has been everything to the black community. Amen?
Amen.
Black church has created hospitals.
Yeah.
We've created schools.
Yeah.
It has been a safe haven for everyone. But it all started because he got up, y'all. He got up, y'all. Amen. Amen. Now let's sing this together. Death, where is your sting? Come on, say.
Death, where is your sting?
Sting, where's your grave?
Sting, where is your grave?
Grave, where is your victory?
Grave, where is your victory?
Yes, he got up.
He got up.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did.
God raised him up.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. Feel good this morning, y'all.
Yeah, me too.
I feel good this morning. Let's go right into it, because God, we are sitting here singing about the King of Kings.
Yes.
Lord of Lords. Amen.
Amen.
You know, Revelation said the rulers that he is the ruler of all the kings on earth. There have been many people who have said that they have ruled the earth. Think of them. Khrushchev, Hitler, Reagan, Kennedy, Stalin, all gone. All gone. But Christ still lives on today. These are all people who thought they were rulers. They thought they ruled the earth. But Revelation said he is the ruler of the kings of the earth. So I don't know about y'all, but that's my king. That's my king. That's my king. Listen, listen, listen. We're going to do a thing called That's My King. And here's what we're going to say. We're going to say,
I wish I could tell you, wish I could describe it, wish I can explain it, can't keep it to myself. There aren't enough colors to paint the whole picture, not enough words to ever say what I found. Wonderful and beautiful and glorious and holy, He is merciful and powerful.
Who we talking about? That's my King.
Hey.
We declare the glory,
hey.
Give Him all the honor, altogether worthy. Who we talking about? That's my King.
Hey.
There's no one before you. Yes, He will adore you. All of this is for you. Who we talking about? That's my King.
Hey, that's my King. Hey, listen, I'm not gonna let the rocks cry without joining the chorus. There's not enough words to make a harmony. It's the song of the angels through all of the ages. It's all of the earth in heaven's symphony.
Listen.
Wonderful and beautiful and glorious and holy, He is merciful and powerful.
Who we talking about? That's my King.
Hey,
we declare the glory.
Yes, sir.
Give Him all the honor. Altogether worthy. Who we talking about? That's my King.
Hey,
there's no one before you. Yes, we will adore you. All of this is for you. Who we talking about? That's my King.
Yes, that's my King. That's my King. Yeah, 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 yeah. Listen, that's my King. That's my God. That's my Shepherd. My Protector. That's my King. That's my Rock. That's my Anchor. My Defender,
that's my King, that's my God, that's my Shepherd,
my Protector, that's my King, that's my Rock, that's my Anchor,
my Defender,
that's it again,
that's my King, that's my God, that's my Shepherd. That's my King. That's my God. That's my anchor.
Listen, 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 listen. Who we talking about?
That's my King.
Hey, we declare the glory.
Give Him all the honor. Altogether worthy. Who we talking about? That's my King. There's no one before you. Yes, we will adore you. All of this is for you. Who we talking about? That's my King. 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 Who we talking about? That's my King.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, who has woke us up this Easter Sunday and allowed us to come to church or log on virtually, we thank you. As young people and as elders, we come before you this morning with eager anticipation. We seek to know you, to see you, to touch you. Guide us as we pray. Open our hearts that we might experience you today. Open our lives that we may be faithful witness of your grace and mercy. May we with shouts of joy this Resurrection Sunday proclaim your steadfast love to all people. Amen and amen.
Amen, amen. Looking over the congregation, I see so many amazing people, important people. Important, when I say important, I mean not only important to me, important to one another, important to your families, important to this community, and most importantly, important to God. Amen. Here we sit as a church in a historic community. In historic community. You know, as a local historian, I'm reminded of the fact that we are right around the corner from where W.E.B. Du Bois lived and got married, right in his house. We are right by where Jackie Robinson lived, right by Ella Fitzgerald and Billie Holiday and Lena Horne, Count Basie and John Coltrane, Milt Hinton. You know, we are around some difference makers, y'all. And I want you to know you're no different than those brothers and sisters who have passed on that have been world changers. Because guess what? That whole time, St. Albans Congregational Church was right here in servicing and serving that same community that brought change to the world. Have you ever heard John Coltrane's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Listen to it. He lived right up there on Mexico Street and Linden Boulevard. So we are the heartbeat, y'all. We got to get it right here. And then we go out there and we shine our light. Because the reality of it, y'all, is He is Lord. And as long as He's on the throne, He got our back. Let's sing this together. He is Lord.
He is Lord.
Let's sing that together, y'all.
He is Lord.
He is risen.
He is risen from the dead, and He is Lord.
Every knee shall bow. Again, let's say, He is Lord, He is Lord.
He is Lord.
Oh, yes, He is, He is.
He is Lord.
My Jesus, He sits on the throne, yeah, yeah.
He is risen.
Early one Sunday morning. Say, He is Lord.
He is Lord.
Come on, sing, church.
He is Lord.
How many know that He is risen?
He has risen from the dead.
From the dead.
And He is Lord.
Every knee shall bow.
That Jesus.
amen. 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 One more time for Jesus, who is our Lord. Oh, we had a really interesting conversation in Sunday school about what Jesus has done for us and what it means to us. And I am, and I know you are, so grateful to God for his wonderful mercies. So today, church, is Resurrection Sunday. We celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I'm waiting. Church, isn't that what this is all about? It's not that Jesus died, it's that he arose. He arose with the power. Y'all know I get really excited real quick. God arose. That power he has then given to us, gifted to us. Amen. It's a wonderful, wonderful thing to be in any church on Resurrection Sunday. But it's an awful blessing to be among you beautiful, beautiful people at St. Albans Congregational Church on Resurrection Sunday. Today is also Youth Sabbath, so you might have noticed that the youth are leading us in our worship today. Amen. Amen. And then it's also the last Sunday of Women's History Month. What an auspicious day, isn't it? Do we have any visitors worshiping with us today? If there are any visitors, would you please stand up so that we can recognize you? Any visitors? Well, amen, 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 amen. Amen. I'd like to say on behalf of our pastor and the entire church, thank you so much for visiting with us this morning. There is an usher who is coming by to bring you a visitor's card. Please do fill it out and hand it either to an usher or a pastor so that we can acknowledge your presence later. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you so much for standing. Amen. And I'd like to give a shout out to everybody who is joining us by the miracles of the World Wide Web. Happy Resurrection Sunday to you too, of course. So I do have a few announcements for us this morning. The first announcement is that the Pastor's Bible Study is on hiatus and will resume on Thursday, April 18th. So Thursday, April 18th, the Pastor's Bible Study will resume. The Reverend Dr. Henry T. Simmons Communion Jazz Vesper service is next Saturday, April 6th. Please join us at 5 p.m. The service is hybrid. It's going to be online and in the sanctuary, so join us as you will. Our guest artist will be the Craig Crawford Players. Our spring revival is Tuesday, April 9th, Wednesday, April 10th, and Thursday, April 11th. We will be having services at 7 p.m. each night in the sanctuary. Our guest preacher is Reverend Onaje Crawford, who is the pastor of the First Hopewell Baptist Church. Looking forward to seeing everybody in revival. One more announcement. How about I just read it? The Reverend Robert Ross Johnson Street Co-Naming Committee, in conjunction with the City Council member Natasha Williams of District 27, invites you to the unveiling ceremony of Reverend Ross Johnson Boulevard in honor of the founding pastor of St. Albans Congregational Church, UCC, at the corner of Linden and Marn Place on Saturday, April 27th, from 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. Church, this is a momentous occasion. Our founding pastor is being honored by having Linden code-named. in his name, I sure do hope to see everybody there. I am stepping away. I will share what I usually share in the beginning, which is namaste. The love and the light in me loves, honors, and respects the light in you. Have a wonderful, wonderful Resurrection Sunday. And we will now have a dance by Dominique Coppin.
They didn't expect me to say nothing right now, but I just want to say this right quick. I know y'all usually see Dominique up here with us singing, but Dominique has lost her voice. Here's the thing. Well, no, not all. She'll get it back. It's not gone for good. Not gone for good. But she has some allergies. But here's why we love Dominique so much. She said, I may have lost my voice, but I can still dance and worship Christ. Amen. So I want y'all to keep that in mind. Dominique, take it away.
Thank you, Jesus. your blood for me, Jesus, on Calvary. Thank you for being born for me, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
For loving me so.
Never, never, never know.
For loving me so. Yeah.
Thank you for your blood. Yeah.
Precious Lamb of God, we may not know what we've done or why God has been so good to us. It hasn't been anything that we've done. It hasn't been anything that we've said. It's simply because God is the Creator and you are God's created people. And being that you are indeed created by the hand of God, you might say to yourself, I don't know why God keeps on waking me up every day. I don't know why he keeps on keeping me, but I want to let you know that the precious Lamb of God loves you, stood in the gap for you, intercedes on your behalf. Somebody here has a testimony. Somebody can say, if it wasn't for the Lord on my side, I'm not sure where I would be. I should be 6 feet in the ground, but I'm still here. I should be in the courthouse, but I'm still here. I should be in the crazy house, but I'm still here. I should be in the jailhouse, but I'm still here. Brother Elijah, it's because of the precious Lamb and love of God that you and I are still here, able to breathe. You just took a breath, didn't you? You just inhaled just now, in through your nose and out through your mouth. That breath you took is the Ruach, the very breath of God that rests inside you and me. That's why we celebrate the resurrection of Christ today. We celebrate the life, the victory of God in Christ Jesus. We thank God for Resurrection Sunday. It only comes once a year for some people, but for those of us who walk the path of righteousness, Resurrection Sunday is every Sunday. God's day is every day. It's not just in the month of March or April, but it's every day, Brother Robert, that God opens my eyes to see a brand new day. That's a good day to praise God and to say thank you for life. Thank you for life most abundantly. Today is a good day. Today is a great day. Today is a God-sized day. Today is the Lord's day, for this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah, somebody. Hallelujah, somebody. Hallelujah, somebody. Don't get quiet now. Go ahead and throw your head back and open your mouth and give God praise from the fruit of your lips and tell him thank you. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for leading me. Thank you for guiding me. Thank you for being a guiding light. Thank you for being a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. We come to the house of the Lord no matter where we are. Near or far, the Holy Spirit is not confined to this building. The Holy Spirit is not confined to one particular space, but the Holy Spirit is like wildfire, Brother John. When a wildfire takes over, it takes a personality and a behavior all of its own. That's how the Holy Spirit works. It's electrified. And when you feel it, when you come in contact with it, sometimes you can't do nothing but say thank you, Jesus, for being in my life. So we thank God on this Resurrection Sunday. We thank God on this Resurrection Sunday. Why you love me so, I may never know. But because of the precious Lamb of God, you and I are able to sit here and look at each other and compliment each other
and smile at each other and tell somebody about what God has done for you this week. And then we come together as the assembly of God and we praise God together because of what God has done for us individually throughout the week and throughout this year. I don't know about y'all, but I'm feeling good. I'm feeling good. I'm feeling good. The Spirit of God is in this place, and a sweet, sweet spirit it is. So I'm gonna try my best to move on. I'm gonna do the best I can. Today is Youth Sabbath also. Amen. On this Resurrection Sunday, we also get to celebrate our young people on today. And so I'm going to introduce the next two pieces or components of this worship experience together. First, I'd like to introduce to some and present to others young Isis Edwards, who is coming to us to give us a moment in celebration of our heritage. And immediately following will be a presentation from our Thinkers in Stars Church School for Resurrection Sunday.
Good morning, church. Today is Resurrection Sunday, and also the end of Women's History Month. I will be doing a moment of celebration of our heritage by speaking about a woman of color who has been a strong ally in the fight for civil rights and social justice for the disadvantaged and marginalized. The Reverend Dr. Yvonne V. Delk is a leader within the United Church of Christ, a Christian educator and social justice advocate. She was the first African-American woman ordained in the United Church of Christ, and the second woman to hold a national leadership role in the denomination. This woman of God was born in Norfolk, Virginia, on April 15th, 1939. The last of three children born to Marcus and Elizabeth Delk. During the Jim Crow era of anti-black racism, threats of violence and poverty, the Delk's family experienced the impact of Jim Crow laws. Her mother and grandmother were her greatest influence, who advised her that, no matter where life takes you, Yvonne, remember who you are and whose you are. Reverend Delk's religious education began at home and at church. She also attended summer camps sponsored by the Convention of the South at Franklinton Center at Bricks in North Carolina. While there, she met several mentors who encouraged her to pursue Christian education. Franklinton Center at Bricks continues today as a retreat and conference center and serves the community. Do you know that our very own Dr. Henry T. Simmons, Pastor Emeritus, serves as chairperson on the Board of Trustees? After graduating from high school in 1957, Reverend Yvonne Delk attended Norfolk State College, a HBCU. While there, she joined the NAACP Youth Council of Virginia and became a young activist. Reverend Delk's role as a black church Christian educator allowed her to impress upon her staff the importance of helping black children to see themselves as liberated, full human beings and not as objects of oppression. After many years of working as a church educator, Reverend Delk was ordained in the United Church of Christ on November 17, 1974. She has struggled to become ordained because the process required a call from the local congregation, But because of her involvement in national activities, she was unable to establish local relationships. To remedy this, the black churches in Virginia collaborated to advocate for her ordination. She continued her studies and earned a doctor ministry degree in New York Theological Seminary. In 1981, she was chosen to lead the UCC's Office of Church and Society, becoming the first black woman and only. The second woman to lead a national department for the UCC. After taking up residence in Chicago, she continued her work in the church and community and founded a Center for African American Theological Studies and contributed to many programs that focus on ecumenism, racial justice, anti-poverty, and the inclusion of the marginalized in religious life. She became an advocate for the LGBTQ participation in church leadership. Dr. Yvonne Delk, ordination and work for the UCC provided a pathway for the inclusion of other women, including Ms. Deborah D. Brayton, and religious leadership. Her work on a black church curriculum inspired others to pursue leadership positions in the UCC. She co-founded the African American Women in Ministry and serves on the Board of Trustees at Franklinton Center at Briggs. Reverend Delk received several awards for her work. Among them, the UCC's Antoinette Brown Award in 1997 for trailblazing leadership. The YWCA Sojourner Truth Racial Justice Award. The Virginia Council of Churches Lifetime Award in Ecumenism. And she was recognized by Ebony Magazine in 2020 as one of the 15 greatest black women preachers in the country. Reverend Dr. Yvonne Delk is a phenomenal preacher, an advocate for justice and Christian education. She is celebrated as a role model for African American women in ministry. Reverend Yvonne Delk is retired but continues to do God's work. This has been a moment in celebration for our heritage. Thank you.
Thank you, Isis. Good morning, church family. Morning. Thinkers and Stars Church School is honored to share with you this Resurrection Sunday. Easter Sunday reminds us that nothing is impossible for God. Jesus' resurrection is the ultimate demonstration of God's love for us. Because of his resurrection, we can have hope and can trust in God's power to overcome anything we face. So now, we're going to hear from our pre-K through second grade class, taught by Nicola DeBedell and Mia Caldwell. They will present This Is Easter. They will be followed by Udella and Idella's Miller Bivens. Udella is in the middle school class, and her sister Idella's is in the elementary school class. They will be singing Easter is a Happy Day. Come on up.
Thank you. Easter. May you know Mary's joy.
This little light of mine, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little
singing a song. Okay. E is for Easter, coming again soon. A is for angels near the tomb. S for stone, which was rolled away. T for tomb, found empty that day. Yes, he is risen. Yes, he is risen. Yes, he is risen. The Bible tells me so. E is for mourning, all are glad. R is for risen, don't be sad. He'll come back for us someday. Until then, we'll watch and pray. Yes, he is.
Today, my sister and I are going to sing a song for Easter.
Easter is a happy day. Hear the children singing. At the Sunday school or play, cheerful voices are ringing. E-A-S-T-E-R, Easter. Day of singing, day of praise. E-A-S-T-E-R, Easter. Christ the living Lord is here.
Thank you. is Carsten, and we will be reciting a poem called On That Day.
By Dolores Steger.
Say your name.
My name is Landon Johnson. We'll be reading On That Day.
My name is Landon Wilson.
On That Day, by Dolores Steger. The bread was broken on that day. There in the upper room. The body broken on that day. Brought with its sadness, gloom.
The wine was served up where the disciples met. The bloodshed brought
flowing from the wounds. Brought with its sadness,
with its cries of woe,
regret. With its sadness, of cries of woe, regret.
Cries of woe, regret.
The bread.
The wine.
The body.
Blood.
The blood. All.
Pointing
to the way of resurrection. Christ arose on that first Easter day.
Thank you to our classes that presented. Serenity, is in our elementary school class, and the teachers for that class are Deacon Raul DeMella and Desiree Edwards. And on the first Sunday, Diane Glover covers this class. The invocation this morning was presented by Nicholas Andrews, and a moment of celebration by Isis Edwards. They're in our senior high class, taught by Dr. Tanya Hendricks. Nathaniel Sibilis will do the prayers of the people. He's in our middle school class. Deacon Stephen Nelson and Dev Caldwell are the teachers for that class. The Sunday school administrative assistant is Nanette Edwards. And as a friendly reminder to everybody, all the adults, church school meets every Sunday at 9 a.m. The teachers are there to welcome and to teach the students. Thank you, and have a blessed Easter Sunday.
Amen. Let's give God another hand clap of praise for our young people, for our Thinkers and Stars Church School. They worked hard, and it's not always easy to stand in front of a crowd or crowded room of people like what we see today, but they got up here and they did a wonderful job. I'd like to just ask all of the teachers and administrators of the Thinkers and Stars Church School, if you're here, please stand. I want the folk to know who our teachers are that are teaching our young people. Amen, amen, amen. And Tanya in the back. And we can use some more teachers, everybody. Amen. It's a priceless work. Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you. It's a priceless work to pour into our young people. And then what's even more exciting is when they grow up and you see that they haven't gone far from it. And to see how that they are becoming successful young adults. And so we want to make that appeal. But I want to thank the teachers, administrators, and to thank our children for sharing and presenting on today. Amen. For this Resurrection Sunday. And so as we move forward in our worship experience, we come to the time where it's time to give. Amen. Praise the Lord. It's time to give. God loves a cheerful giver. Remember when Abraham came back from battle while working to save his nephew Lot from some kings that he was under their hand, if you will. And after he came back and he had all of this wealth that was given to him, he did not earn it on his own.
But when a blessing was pronounced upon him, he gave 10% of everything that he did not earn for himself. And so we are grateful. We earn it today, and we are grateful that God gives us what God gives us. And he only asks for a portion in return. And so let us prepare our hearts and minds to give. If you are on campus or you are online, you can use our text to give option. If you're online, you should see it right there at the bottom of your screen. Well, you want to text the message SACCUCC. Text that message to the number 73256. Remember, you will get a receipt. Keep that receipt for your filing system because your gifts and donations are tax deductible. And so we want to take this moment to prepare our hearts and minds to give liberally, to give graciously, to give cheerfully. Let us prepare to give at this time. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Bring that around. Every now and then I get inspired to write something, and I felt that this might be the perfect opportunity to do something about the resurrection of Christ. Amen. Amen. Let's go. Put your hands together, y'all. So this song is called Sunday Morning, and y'all are gonna sing this with us.
He died upon the cross, he did it all just to save me now. No matter what they did, he said that he wasn't coming down. When nails in his hands, and on his head was a thorn crown.
Come on.
Jesus died and he rose for you.
Yes, he did.
Jesus died and he rose for you.
Hey.
Jesus died and he rose for you. On Sunday morning for you. On Sunday morning.
Jesus rose. Yes, he did.
Jesus died and he rose for you.
On Sunday morning.
Jesus died and he rose for you.
Rose to rock away.
Jesus died and he rose for you.
Listen, this next part right here, I want y'all to sing along with me. We're going to show you how this goes. All you have to say is, rose. He rose. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Listen.
He rose up.
Indeed. And we thank you, O God, for this time of giving. We thank you, Father, that the resources and donations that are able to come in, Father, that we are able to take care of our own and that we are able to be available to the larger community. So we thank you on this day, Resurrection Sunday, for the gifts that have been given. We thank and we ask that you bless the giver that has given it. And we ask that you bless even those who are unable to give on this day. And know, Father, that it all will be used for the upbuilding of your kingdom in this 21st century. In the precious name of Christ we pray, amen. Amen. As we come forward, as we begin to move forward in our worship experience, we move to the time of prayer. Prayer is a tool, key, that works for each and every one of us. It's a power tool that we can use, a key that helps unlock the kingdom. And so we come today with prayerful hearts as we lift those who are on our healing and care list. We want to continue to pray for others who have also requested prayer. We want to continue to keep Sarah McWallace and her family lifted in prayer, Reverend Dr. Tony Waldron and family lifted in prayer, the Harris, Amsterdam, Scott, and Miller family lifted in prayer, Sister Lavinia Banks and family, Deacon Fanny Smiths and family, Deacon Sandra Holmes and family. We want to keep all lifted in prayer. And also this morning, Sister Marlene Edwards has asked for prayer requests for her daughter-in-law, Tracy Edwards, her sister, Alseek McNaught, who both of them had surgery on last week. And so we want to keep the Edwards and McNaught family lifted in prayer. And perhaps there is something pressing upon your heart, something that's been burdensome to you. You've been trying to carry it all by yourself. You've been trying to walk this part of the journey on your own. But Christ is risen means that we don't have to walk that part of the journey by ourselves. And so I encourage you to take it to the Lord in prayer. We have asked young Nathaniel Siblis if he will come from, I think it's at Stars Church School, part of our youth program here, if he would come and lead us in a word of prayer to help usher us to the throne of grace as he prays on behalf of the people.
Good morning, church. Let us bow our heads, close our eyes as we begin for a word of prayer. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, we humbly gather before you on this Resurrection Sunday, pouring our hearts to you, O Lord. Lord Jesus, your death on the cross for our sins was priceless, and we thank you. Continue to bless the leaders of our church, like Reverend Eli Wilson III, Reverend Jennifer Heron, Reverend Franklin Wilson, our deacons, church school teachers, and others that I might not have mentioned. Lord, in the recent days, I have firsthand seen that you do work miracles, and I'm grateful for that. Thank you for continued grace and mercies that are renewed each day, the blessings on our lives. You are awesome, magnificent, and we give you the glory, Lord, the honor and the praise that you deserve. Heavenly Father, I pray for those of us who are sick and are shut in. Heal them, Lord, and comfort the ones who have lost their loved ones. As said in Matthew chapter 5, verse 43 to 44, you have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Lord, there's so much hurt and pain going around in this world today. Please touch the minds and hearts of those making decisions that are hurting others. While I might be too young to understand politics, I can see what's happening in this country and other places around the world, and I fear for the people that have to suffer, Lord. Please take control of the bad things that are happening and give us peace, hope, and joy once more. Let us show love to each other as you have loved us. Lord, thank you for the families, parents, and our loved ones, our teachers and church school teachers, those who have been helping us to be educated and prepare us for life. Our daily challenges as children are many, but without proper guidance, we would be lost. So Lord, we are grateful for all you have done for us. Continue to bless the lives of those who are guiding us, Lord. I ask all these things in your name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Before we go into the sermonic, you guys can give me some background music as I talk. You ever watch a movie and a person says something, but then they play sad music, all of a sudden you want to cry? Music is powerful. You know, I just want to let y'all know, I am a part of an organization called the King Movement. And I just want to say, all the men here, all right, if you've never heard of the King Movement, I want you to go right out and Google that, the King Movement. It's a movement for men. And the founder of that is here with us. I ain't going to embarrass you, brother. We got Brother Chris Broussard here, and I am a member of that. Yes. Oh, yeah. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall feel no evil because God is with me. In other words, God is here. God is here, y'all. God is here. Doesn't it feel good to know that God is here? Of all places that God could be, God is here. Think about that for a minute. And think about what that means for you. In me, that God is here. Thank you.
sweet night in this sanctuary. There is a stillness in the atmosphere.
I usually give people. I tell people that my prayer is always, thy will be done. Not my will, but your will. And my prayer is to always recognize the voice of God when I hear it. Because there's a lot of voices out there, a lot of people pulling at you and saying things. But I always pray to recognize the voice of God when I hear it. And I want you to speak. God, speak. And I will listen. Say go, and I will go. Lead, and I will follow. Amen. Amen. I want us all to say this together. We're just gonna say, speak, Lord. We're just gonna say, speak, Lord. Let's say that right now. Let's say, we're gonna say,
speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
Y'all can join in there.
Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
Till I want you to speak to me this morning.
Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
Oh, Lord.
Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
I want you to speak to me, Lord, yeah.
Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
Because if I don't hear from you, Lord, yeah.
Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
I don't know what I would do.
Speak, Lord.
Lord, speak, Lord.
Speak to me, Lord.
Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
When he's dead, he said, woman, behold your son.
Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
My God, why have thou forsaken?
Lord, speak, Lord. Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
Lord said, I thirst when he was on the cross,
speak,
yes, he did.
Lord, speak, Lord.
Jesus said, I thirst when he was on the cross, yes, he
speak,
did.
Lord, speak, Lord.
Then he said, it is finished, yes, he did. He said,
speak, Lord, speak. Lord,
speak, Lord,
speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
Father, into your hands, yeah.
Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
Father, into your hands, I commit my spirit.
Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
Yes, Father, into your hands, I commit
speak,
my spirit.
Lord, speak, Lord.
Speak to me, Jesus. Speak to me, speak to me.
Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
I want to ask y'all this question. Are you listening?
Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
Yes, are you listening when Jesus speaks to you?
Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
Yes, are you listening?
Yes. Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
Speak, Lord, speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
Jesus, I love you.
Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
Hey, Jesus, I love you.
Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
Jesus, I love you.
Speak, Lord, speak, Lord.
Listen, listen, listen. Oh, come lay down. Listen, listen.
Oh, come lay down the burdens you have carried. For in this age you weary, God is He.
Hallelujah.
Amen. The time has been well spent. I am not going to belabor for a long time. But I would like to read into your hearing from the Gospel of John two passages. Both come from John chapter 20. I want to read the first part of verse 1. We call it 1A in seminary. And then I want to skip to verse 19. So that's the Gospel of John chapter 20, verse 1A, and then verse 19. And the Bible says this: early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark. Verse 19. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." For the few moments we have together, I'd like to talk to you from the thought, from the subject matter, expect the unexpected. Expect the unexpected. Let us pray. Speak, Lord. Speak, Lord.
for your servants, your people, are listening. Holy Spirit, speak to me, speak through me, that your people may hear a word, not from Eli, but will hear a word from the Lord God on high, that we all will be edified, but most importantly, O God, your name will be glorified, and we will be so careful to give you the glory, the honor, and the praise that you so richly deserve. It's in the precious name of Christ we pray and give thanks. Amen, amen, and amen. I just real quick want to give a shout out to the band. It's all good. It's all good. They didn't even know they were gonna all be wearing blue today, but everybody's wearing blue. Got the Easter colors on. Amen. And I just want to always give a shout out to the band, but also to the Sight and Sound Ministry, to our sound engineers, and to our Chelios Films, our streaming partner. We'd like to thank them for their continued effort and hard work. You know, I was thinking, I called my brother last night, and I was like, man, what are some of the things we used to do on Saturdays when we were growing up? See, we grew up on 114th Drive and Francis Lewis Boulevard across the street from what was then called Andrew Jackson High School. And I was thinking of some things and writing some things, and I called my brother because I knew that undoubtedly my brother was going to remember things that I had long forgotten. And because my brother has a very long memory. And so we started talking about some of the things we used to do on Saturday mornings, and we started reminiscing about how we used to watch cartoons, Saturday morning cartoons like Fat Albert. Yeah. I don't care what y'all say about Bill Cosby, he has done some brilliant work. We watched Fat Albert, we used to watch Scooby-Doo, Gummy Bears, Smurfs, Alvin and the Chipmunks. Some of the other things we did on Saturdays, maybe when it got later on in the early afternoon, we would watch Soul Train. Maybe Mom would take us to Lacey's skating rink. We would sometimes go outside and play football, two-hand touch in the street. Sometimes we would scale the fence of Jackson and sneak onto the football field and play tackle football. But then we'd all go home at some point because the karate flicks were coming on. The Five Deadly Venoms, the Kid with the Golden Arms, the Drunken Monkey. We would go and watch karate flicks that usually came on from about 3 p.m. to 5 p.m. We would do other things like sit on the stoop or go and ride our bikes or play basketball. We would take an old bicycle rim and we would pull the spokes out the rim and nail it to the light post, and we play basketball in the street. Then later on Saturday night, we would watch Amen, 227, Golden Girls, Emptiness. And if our parents let us stay up late enough, we might get into a little bit of Saturday Night Live. But what we were really waiting for was Showtime at the Apollo. We wanted to see David Peaston and Steve Harvey and the young lady that used to host back in the day, and the folks that would come on, and stars who weren't stars then that came out and became something. We on Saturdays would eat dinner together around the table. We would drink water from one of the neighbor's water hose. We would play Nintendo and Atari, and we would play ColecoVision and Sega Genesis. And on some Saturdays, we would go to church because that's when the youth ministry would meet from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m., where we would go and spend time with our friends in choir rehearsal and Bible study and arts and crafts and maybe even drama practice. That was what Saturdays looked like for me and my brother, but that's when we were young. When we grew up, my brother not so much, but me, I was at the club. I was at the Muse and I was at, you know, Bentley's and these places. When I got old enough to go, I went to the clubs and the parties, and then I would get home at 2 in the morning and my mother would wake me up at 5:30 in the morning and say, if you can give time to the club, you can give time to the Lord. Back when I was growing up, it wasn't a question if you wanted to go to church, it was a statement. Get up, put your clothes on, get a shower, we're going to church. But then as I've gotten even older, a lot of my Saturdays have been filled not just with weddings, but with funerals. But this Saturday that we see in the text, when we look at the first verse, is a different kind of Saturday.
It's a Saturday that they that our ancestors were waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting after Jesus' body had been taken off of that cross and prepared for that borrowed tomb. They were waiting in hope. They were waiting even with patience. They were waiting with confusion and questions. Do you know what it's like to be in the waiting room of life's hopes and dreams? Waiting is hard. It's difficult sometimes. And we tend to wonder in our thinking and in our behavior while we are waiting. We find ourselves like those who stood at the foot of the cross marked with the grief of Friday, but there was hope still on Saturday. We were waiting for something to happen, but nothing happened. Nobody knew how long Saturday would last. They didn't have the Bible like we have today. We know on Maundy Thursday that by the time early Sunday morning comes, we're going to celebrate the victory of Christ. But in that day, they didn't have the Bible, the scripture, the holy word of God that we have today. So they didn't know what was going to happen next. Nobody knew if Saturday would ever end. Saturday, what does it represent? I'm glad you asked that question. Saturday represents that in-between day. In between stillness and doubt, in between doubt and despair. It is that place in between that where time seems to stand still, but it's also a place that we can take the old stuff that happened before Saturday, that happened before Friday. We can abandon all of that, the stuff that abandoned us or the stuff that disappointed us. We can put all of that old stuff away. Remember putting new wine in new wineskins? The old Saturday, the back in the day, the person I used to be. You ever been in the street and somebody tested your patience, they plucked your last nerve, and you had to tell them, if I was my old self, I'd do some things. I might have said some things. But when you live in Christ, you are a new creature. That old stuff that abandoned us, the disappointments that we've carried, the burdens that have been heavy upon our shoulders, and that leads to the kind of Saturdays that we experience today in the 21st century, where we still see oppression and we still see genocide and we still see racism and we still see people being mistreated. And then comes our specific or personal Saturdays when we have to still live through or live with the consequences of 9/11. We still have to deal with a Supreme Court that has taken the rights away from our sisters. We still have to deal with voting rights. We still have to deal with January 6th and its fallout. We still have to deal with the economic collapse of Saturday, the overwhelming failure of the justice system, a justice system that has no adequate resources. We're still living in the Saturday of the 21st century, being exposed to food and home insecurities and corporation corruption. In the midst of that desperate stillness, stay with me, I'm going somewhere. In the midst of that desperate stillness, we, the church today, have an opportunity to listen yet again to this alternative narrative, to be able to expect the unexpected. In this desperate stillness, God interrupts human history. In this desperate stillness, he intrudes into human history. In this desperate stillness, God summons and even God haunts our hearts as it relates to the things that are happening in humanity even today. God interrupts with conversation. Sometimes we are talking about stuff that don't even matter, and not talking enough about the stuff that does. And sometimes we just nervous talking. We talking because we don't want to be silent. Or being silent is an inconvenient, uncomfortable place for us. I'm guilty. I had a homeboy back in the day. We were roommates, and he was totally okay riding in the car with no radio, no sound, no nothing. And I realized in that moment, wait a minute, I'm not cool with this. It's got to be some sound, some something. Sometimes for silence for some of us is an uncomfortable place to be. So we talk in order to avoid such silence, but God will interrupt that conversation because of the desperate stillness of Saturday evening. God uses this alternative narrative that we yet again are able to learn and reflect on that intrudes into our situation. Sometimes while we are waiting, our mind starts to wander and our behavior starts to move in a direction that's not healthy for us. But even then, God will intrude into our situation. God will call us and challenge us. And even in places of oppression, God will make us angry so that we'll get up and do something about it. So the key character of this alternative narrative that God shows us in Christ Jesus, this other narrative, that the key character around which we gather on this day is that Friday's Jesus is done in by the rulers of that age. There are people here today still trying to keep the church from being successful, trying to lead the church, but the reality is the church is supposed to lead society. We are supposed to be the example, and then the rest of the world should say, that's the example I want to follow. But instead, oftentimes the church, and you've heard me say this before, is so enculturated that it has little power to act and to believe. And so instead of the church leading society, society is leading the church. Uh-oh. Friday's Jesus is done in by those that thought they had the power, by those who had perceived power, those who mocked and scorned and spat on Jesus and whipped him and put that crown of thorns on his head. They thought they had the power. They thought they had the power. People of that day knew this much, that the rulers, that the imperialistic system was the ones, the religious leaders of the day were the ones who crucified Jesus on that cross. People at least knew that much. But the wonder of this narrative around which we gather today is that Friday's Jesus did not linger long on Saturday. It was delayed, but it did not tarry. What you mean? Delayed and tarry pretty much means the same thing. Remember when God told Habakkuk, I'm working a work, and though it may seem delayed, the answer will not tarry. In other words, God says, I will do it in my time. My ways are not your ways. My thoughts are not your thoughts. Friday's Jesus did not linger long on Saturday, because on while Saturday night, much like we would wait till 1 a.m. to watch Showtime at the Apollo, in the wee midnight hours, there was a sister by the name of Mary Magdalene. And Mary Magdalene with the other Mary and some other sisters that were out there mourning and grieving the loss of the Savior, Jesus the Christ, and was looking for just as much answers as anybody else who had seen Jesus do multiple miracles and be in the blessing business. They were just as grieved as everyone else. But Mary Magdalene, when everybody else went home, there were some sisters who stayed. There were some sisters who stayed, and eventually they saw that the rock had been rolled away. And the Bible says that when Mary Magdalene went into the tomb, there were some angels there that said, "Why are you here? Jesus is not here. He's not dead. He has risen, and he has risen indeed. Go into Jerusalem and tell your brothers that Christ lives." The gospel was brought by the sisters first. And I argue, Tony, that the reason why that God would have it for sisters to bring the gospel to the rest of the world first is because God had to undo what was done in the garden. Oh, man. Deceivery entered. Satan took something that was attractive. If you love butterscotch candy, Satan is not going to come to you with a peppermint. He's going to give you a butterscotch piece of candy because that's what you like. So posturing himself in a way, and understand that Adam and Eve would not have understood the serpent as coming from anything else but God, because all they knew was God. because of the connection with God. But that connection was broken first through the sister and then to the brother that happened in the garden. And I argue that the reason why sisters bring the gospel to the rest of the world, to the nations at large, is because God, in his infinite and in his providence, undid what Satan did in the garden. Did it at the tomb. But you can't stay at the tomb. You got to run tell that. So, Friday's Jesus did not linger long on Saturday, and he ends up being Sunday's Jesus. He ends up being Sunday's Jesus on the first day of the week, on the first day of the new world, the first day of new life. Sunday's Jesus is urgent among us because it is clear that the old ways of doing things, in turn, when it comes to money and power and violence and control, has failed. But there's another way. If you're willing to expect the unexpected, there's another way. You're asking, what is that other way? That another way? Well, I want to share with you something. There's a film called Vantage Point. It came out several years ago, and there's a crime that is committed, and the whole film is about the fact that there are four different perspectives of the same crime. And so everybody is looking at the same thing, but because of their vantage point, they see something different that someone else may not have seen. So when we start to look at this another way, and I'm going to take my seat, we got to first ask the question, who moved the stone? Who moved the stone? When you go to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they all have an account of Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection. But I went over to Mark, and I was looking for how the stone was moved, but Mark didn't tell me anything about how the stone was moved. When I went over to Luke, and I was trying to see if Luke addressed the issue of how the stone was moved, Luke didn't tell me anything about how the stone was moved. I even looked over at John, known as the beloved disciple, and I still couldn't find anything about how the stone was moved. But when you go to the Gospel of Matthew and you look in chapter 28, right there in the first verse, it tells you that the angels of the Lord came from on high and came down low and moved that stone out of the way, that Jesus's body might not be found there. See, what I'm trying to say is all of us have a different vantage point. We can look at the exact same thing and see something totally different. And so I want to let you know and remind you that on this Easter Sunday, we ponder that contradiction between empire, death, and Easter life, to consider our own faith amid the empire and to be dazzled by the one who said then and who says now, peace. Peace, I recruit you for the forgiveness business. I charge you with healing, and I charge you with transformative reconciliation. And my brothers and my sisters, that's a hard work for the church to do, because the empire is not into giving free lunches. The empire is not into giving an open hand or a helping hand. The empire is not into breaking the vicious cycles of fear and violence and failure. So here it is right here. What if we became civil disobedient people when it comes to preaching the resurrection of Christ? When it comes to taking that message somewhere, I'm not talking about going and just destroy a bunch of stores and beating up on our own brothers and sisters' businesses and burning out and breaking windows. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about violence. I'm just talking about being a bit unruly when it comes to some of the rules and regulations that imperialistic powers tries to put on us. We call it oppression. What if we were just civilly disobedient? Make it a little difficult. You know, when you put your clothes in a wash machine, there's a mode called an agitator. What if we became agitators? Agitators of the resurrection. Whoo, I'm gonna preach that another time. Let's see what would happen. Let's see if life is longer than death. Some will never move and will keep trusting in the empire, but we know this much.
that the very Ruach of God, the breath of God, has breathed on us. And we have been addressed. To us, Christ says, even today, peace be with you. And I love the way the psalmist writes it. He says, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know who holds the future. And life is worth living just because he lives. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Amen. He got up. God raised him up. He got up with all power in his hands, because he is Lord. He is Lord. And I don't know about you, but I'm glad to say that's my King. Did y'all pick up on it already? These are the songs we've been singing all day. Hey, Jackie. How you doing? That's my King. He is the precious Lamb of God. And here we are on Sunday morning celebrating the fact that God is here. So we thank God for his Son and our Savior. And because he got up on, they hung him high, they stretched him wide. He hung his head and then he died, but that's not how the story ends. For on that third day, after waiting all day on Saturday, they came to the tomb. The stone was rolled away. The tomb was empty. Then he came to his own, said, peace is with you right now. Go to Jerusalem. Wait there for your helper, the counselor, the Holy Spirit to come. I must ascend to the Father now. I can't stay here, but I won't leave you, nor will I forsake you. For my helper is coming to be with you, to lead and to guide you. And next week we begin to look at the coming of the Holy Spirit. The crown of fire, it felt like, upon their head. Speaking in the language of everyone who was there, though they were not from that place. That the freedom to preach the gospel came in that moment. Peter didn't stop to give a title. He didn't stop to say, we're going to talk about this. He simply started preaching the good news of Jesus Christ. And said, the one that you rejected has now become the cornerstone of God's church. And we are going to go out, do with us whatever you desire. But we have fire shut up in our bones, and we can't keep quiet about the goodness of God and the good news of Jesus Christ. And my brothers and my sisters, I pray that like then, our ancestors that came before us, that were on fire for God, that you carry that same torch and you carry it wherever you go, that we can shine like our children shine today. That we sang today, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. You might have a flashlight, you might have a lighter, you might have a match, you might have a match, that might be all the light you have, but if that's all the light you have, you go ahead and let that light shine. That we may continue to have favor upon, showered upon our lives. That we may be able to hear the voice of God clearly. That we may be able to see our instruction and guidance with clarity. That we may walk with the utmost conviction and confidence, knowing that we serve the true and living God who loves us, who keeps us, who carries us, provides us with joy, that we can live to fight another day. So I don't know about you, but I thank God
for life, and I thank God for life most abundantly. And with that being said, we do open the doors of the church for anyone who does not know Jesus Christ and the free pardon of their sin. Let me tell you something. This is not about religion. This is about relationship. I don't care if you're Buddhist or Muslim or any Confucian. It doesn't matter. Do you know Christ? What do you mean, Eli? Do you know love? Do you know joy? Do you know how to smile? Do you know how to encourage? Can you bring peace to wherever you go? It doesn't matter what your religious affiliation is, but it does matter if you know Christ. If you know the Creator for yourself. If you know the Most High God for yourself. And so, it's not about religion. It's about relationship. So if you don't know Christ and the free pardon of your sin, we want to invite you to come now. Amen, sister. Amen. If you're looking for a church home, if you're looking for a church home, we're not a perfect church, but we're a loving church. We'll accept you no matter where you come from, what your background is. I don't care. What I do care about is your soul. And your soul is where the Spirit of God meets the consciousness of your mind. In that place is what I care about. If there's another, you're looking for a church home, or you like to rededicate your life to Christ, come on up. Come on up. Come on up. Victory. And I love him. I love him. I really love the Lord. Let's do that again. You don't know. You don't know what he's done for me. Amen, amen. Amen. Last Sunday, we had a sister come up to give her life to Christ. If you remember, her name was Zayla. This Sunday, we have another sister, Georgette, who's giving her life to Christ.
Amen.
Please.
Amen.
The angels are celebrating right now. The least we can do is put our hands together and give God some praise that one more has joined God's family on this day. We give God praise on this Resurrection Sunday because Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. We thank God for this soul who has come on this day. Amen. If there's another, the doors of God's church never close. This building will lock. The lights will be turned off. The alarm will be set. But God's church, the doors of God's church, never, ever, ever close. And so if you wanted to come but you were a little shy, it's all right. Talk to me. Talk to one of our deacons. Talk to one of our ushers. We'll be more than happy to sit with you and to go to the lengths, the steps that we have to go through to get to where we need to go. This is about our soul. If we walk out this door, God forbid, and get hit by the Q4 bus, can you say that heaven is your home? That's all I'm trying to say. Because if you're not sure, if you're not sure, you're like, nah, I'm talking to you. But if you don't want to walk, it's fine. I don't want to put you on Front Street like that. But all you got to do is confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ died for your sins, that he was put in a borrowed tomb, but that he was risen from the dead. All you got to do is confess with your mouth and believe in your heart those things. And the Bible says you shall be saved. For God so loved the whole world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever, that's everybody, anybody, somebody, believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. We bless God on this day. bless God on this day. Let's give God one more hand clap of praise for this sister, Georgette, who has come today. Amen. I'm going to ask Brother Howard Siblis and his family to come forward, Nathaniel as well. I'd like for Brother Clint Long, he's our photographer, here he is, he's been, this is our last piece, everybody, and then we're going to adjourn. I know somebody's hungry. I think I heard some stomachs rumbling. So we're going, the time again has been well spent. We are going to pray for this family, the Siblis family, and we're gonna pray for the Long family. And we're going to pray for Sister Georgette, who has come as well. And I invite you to join us in prayer. What do we mean by that? If you hear, thank you, Lord, and your heart agrees, then perhaps you will say, thank you, Lord. And if not, your heart will say it for you. But we want to be on one accord. We are praying at a later date. We'll give you more information behind why we're praying. But until that time that I have permission to share that with you, I'm not. Amen. Y'all was supposed to laugh right there. I guess it was just funny to me. So we want to pray for this family, actually. Do it this way. We want to pray for the Siblis family. They've had a rough week, but a good week. We want to pray for the Long family and all that they are faced with, good, bad, and ugly. And we want to pray for our sister, Georgette, who has come today to give her life to Christ. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for these families that are represented here today. Father, in the name of Jesus, there's some comfort that needs to be had, some encouragement that needs to be given. We need your comfort and your peace in this time of struggle. We have some concerns, Father. We have some questions, Lord. We're not sure at every turn what's going to happen, but what we are sure about is we are sure about your grace and we are sure about your mercy, because that net catches us every time. And so you know the concerns of all who are standing here today. You know what they stand in need of. And Father, we're asking and praying in the name of Jesus that you provide them for their every need. Give them peace. Give them comfort. Let them know that you are with them and that they are not walking alone. We ask that you watch over Brother Clint. We ask that you carry him through the concerns that he has immediately in front of him. We pray in the name of Jesus, oh God, that you be all for him that no one else can. We pray in the name of Jesus, oh God, that anyone that he comes in contact with, your angels will have already touched their minds, touched their hands, their bodies, and their spirits to be able to help Clinton in his time of need. We ask that you bless his family, continue to support them and encourage them, allow them to gather around the patriarch of their family to pray for him and to love on him and to let him know that they will always be there with and for him. We pray, oh God, that as you carry him through, that he will look to you, oh God, for everything. That he will pray unto you, that he will ask you for your help. Because sometimes as men, Father, we can be egotistic and not ask for help. But I pray that you move upon his heart to come to you at every turn in his life. And that you will continue to shower your blessings upon him. And that he would always give you the glory, the honor, and the praise that you always deserve. We ask and we thank you, oh God, for the life of Howard Siblis. We thank you for the life of Michelle Siblis. We thank you for the life of Nathaniel Siblis. This family has faced much on today, oh God, but you've brought them through. You've already shown a breakthrough in more ways than one. It is grateful to see when a family can walk through the doors of the church with huge smiles on their face, and you know what they just went through not 72 hours ago. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for being a healer. I thank you for being a provider. I thank you for being an encourager. I thank you for being one who can hold the whole world in the palm of your hand. I ask, Father, in the name of Jesus, that you continue to walk with this family. Continue to prop them up on every leaning side. Continue to be with them and wipe away all of the tears of their heart, Father. In their time of sorrow or grief or just difficulty, just show up and show out. Just remind them that you are with them. Continue to watch over young Nathaniel as he is growing into to become a wonderful and responsible adult. We thank you for his prayers that he has bestowed upon us whenever he prays before this congregation. We ask that you continue to be with him in school, in his studies, as he travels to and fro. We pray on this day for his mother as well. We pray, Father, that you continue to give her the strength and the courage to stand up in it all. And we ask, oh God, as we are asking right now, Father, we're just asking again that you cover everyone standing in this circle. Thank you for young Georgette, who came forward to give her life to Christ on this day. We pray for her in the name of Jesus. We know that heaven is shouting right now because another has come into the fold of God's body, of God's village, of God's community. We ask that you continue to bless her, God. Help her to know that when we give our lives to Christ, don't mean problems go away. The bill collector's gonna keep on calling, but we don't have to walk as a people without hope. We can walk as a people with hope, knowing that you are leading and guiding and carrying us, walking and talking with us. So have your way. Because you live, Father, we can face tomorrow. Because you live, all fear is gone. Because you live, we know who holds the future, and life has been worth living just because, Father, you live. Bless us all as we pronounce the benediction right now. We ask that you bless everyone who has come here today, and we pray that this worship experience has been a blessing for everyone who has come, everyone who has watched online and worshiped alongside us. Continue to have your way in our lives. Watch between us until next we shall meet again. We praise you, we thank you, we lift your holy and righteous name. It's in the precious name of Christ we pray and give thanks. And all of God's children said, amen, amen, and amen. Beloved, until next we shall meet again, may God bless you, may God keep you, may God bestow his richest blessings upon you always. And remember, don't let anybody steal your joy. God bless you, everyone. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Don't eat too much. God bless.